She'll never learn to fly.
Why?
She can't. It isn't in her genes. Pants. The birds here don't eat from higher plants.
The fathers of their forefathers would soar, dip and dive.
Flip and glide to impress each other.
Or get a fresh perspective.
Or taste the tippy tops of trees.
But the fruit they plucked from all their knees was just as juicy, sweet.
Just as plentiful.
Tender, meaty, fibrous, tannic, tart.
For no self-important parasitic species ever came into their heart.
And wings can be used for many things.
Feather dusting. Back rubs.
Or shape-shifting while one sings. Fluttering and flapping to enhance a mating dance.
But all that dancing made their bottoms bigger. So they had to change their pants.
Jeans.
Those lovely lazy wings.
Couldn't lift that mass of legs and ass and that.
What's that?
Dr. Corbett Vault, and I am a certified bird nutritionist. Tonight, I will tell you some bird facts about bird nutrition. Smaller birds eat more relative to their body weight. A hummingbird each day can eat 100% of its weight in food, but the common raven, only 4%. Birds eat lots of things, rodents, snakes, insects, nectar, and fruit. Fruit are an excellent source of carbohydrates, minerals, and vitamins. Any fruits that humans can eat are also nutritious for birds. Except avocados. Never feed an avocado to a bird because it is very, very poisonous. Fruits like apples and plums have seeds and pits that should be removed before feeding to a bird because they have small amounts of cyanide, which is not good for birds either. Yeah. Fruit-eating animals are called frugivores, and which I think is pretty cool. Let's see, what else do we have? Bread has little nutritional value for birds. In fact, it can cause a very unhealthy condition called angel wing. In this condition, the last joint of the wing is twisted out so that at rest, it sticks out instead of lying flat against the body. This can cause flightlessness and, an early death in birds, which is not good. If you must feed birds, you can feed them defrosted peas, uncooked oatmeal, or bird seed. You can also plant native Pennsylvanian fruits in your backyard, like pawpaws, blueberries, and service berries. Some fruits and birds have a symbiotic relationship. Fruits provide birds with food, and then birds poop out the seeds, or regurgitate the seeds and spread the fruits everywhere. Fruit-eating birds have less muscular gizzards and a shorter intestinal tract, so when the seeds pass through the bird, it doesn't damage them as much. Anyway, thank you for listening to some bird talk.
Wow! Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
You're investigating the classical theory of birdsong. I would argue the nuance of which is so often overlooked in these postmodern days. Frequently, we desire great specificity, or we're lazy and we require a great all-encompassing thesis. Today, I hope to remind you of the brief internal history each of you have on your own, and perhaps awaken a closeness to this internal song that'll help us better understand the nuance of birdsong. I myself was uninterested in birds for many years. Ludicrous. I lived in great terror of birds, so free and upwards and outward facing they were in the world. Consider the robin, plodding along in the park dutifully. No care in the world. There she is. It was a boldness that I personally could not fathom. Or consider the ubiquitous pigeon, his slow and seductive saunter, and that particularly sexy cooing sound. So confident in his goings-on, and that profound puffed-upness that he has, traipsing about in that every place, the courthouse, the boulevard, your apartment window. Their earnestness perturbed me, to be honest. A song too early in the morning, devastating, distracting, a repeated call in the afternoon when I'm trying to study, outrageous. And so it's that I must situate my own self in my studies of birdsong with real vulnerable love and care. And so I tell you that I'm a fish. It is what I am. I myself always preferred fish, astrologically, philosophically, anatomically, and sonically. For a great long part of my life. Fish have actually been reported to sing a dawn chorus, not unlike birds. And here's the rub. You might remember the original great divide in the analyses of bird song and understanding the magic of their song. There's the, what I'd argue, a very cruel and largely artificial divide between the songbird and the not songbird. They're categorized, typologized, and forever damned to be one or the other, unfree to move in between the two. But it's here today that I posit to you, dear listener, a different thesis entirely. The 10,000 birds that we know, they all make sounds. We know this to be true. It's a pretty simple suggestion, but I would say a critical one. There's great variety, and to this end, I suggest we be radically kind in our analysis of all their sounds, and rather look at it as a spectrum of call to song. So to this end, I would say we need to remember one specific thing. All we do is make sound with purpose. And it's for that specific purpose that we must listen closely and attentively.
low pressure, sucking the wing upward. Insect wings are covered in cross-connected veins but lack any skeletal structure. Bird wings are light and bony, covered in warm, waterproof feathers. Insects have two pairs of wings, while birds only have a single pair. Strong breast muscles on birds flap their wings and generate the lift. The sweeping motion produces lift as each flap of the wings propels the bird forward. This sweeping, flapping, flying motion makes it almost impossible to hover. Birds can generate lift by spreading their wings and riding thermal updrafts. These are columns of warm air rising from the ground. Once lift has been created, birds angle their bodies downward to transfer that elevation into forward momentum. As lift turns into forward momentum, birds can use this energy to create even more lift. This is how birds can soar over continents without using much energy at all. Birds taking off from the ground will begin from a running start. These are often large birds that spend time soaring with broad wings. Birds taking off from trees usually jump off and glide. They jump onto the lift needed for flight. Insects have no interest in pursuing forward momentum. Their wings flap vertically, not horizontally like a bird. Each stroke of an insect's wings catches air, then brutally forces it down below their bodies. This creates an equal and opposite reaction, pushing them up. Unlike birds, most insects can hover in one spot. By beating their wings down quickly and the circular motions of their multi-segment wings, like they are clawing their way through the air. This motion doesn't allow for any soaring or gliding. Birds and bugs often share the same takeoff strategy. This is the most energy-intense part of flight.
Thank you.
I'll try to learn to swim.
You want them to die?
No, I want them to win.
How?
By learning cooperation.
They are. The bugs and the birds are getting along, buzzing and chirping together in song.
But something is wrong.
It is?
Yes. The birds are flying away from their friends.
But also the enemy.
True. But if the birds can overcome looking at bugs as food, maybe in time their fluttering hearts will have room to divide.
Sigh. I wish you were right.
They already flew.
Oh.
Goodbye. Adieu.